Let's stand and sing the King of My Heart together. Let the King of My Heart. Let the King of My Heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, He is my song. Let the King of My Heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, He is my song. You are good. the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. Yes, thank you, Lord, that you're so good to us. Lord, you bless us in so many ways. You provide for our needs, Lord. And most of all, you sent your Son to earth as a child, as a baby, to give us, to come as a gift, the greatest gift of all. And through your Son, Jesus, we have hope. And we know that you are with us. So, Lord Jesus, we call on your Holy Spirit to come tonight, to be with us, to help us worship you, to help us connect with you and hear your voice, know how you are calling us to live, and how you're calling us to serve you in our lives this week. So we call on your Spirit to come, Holy Spirit. Oh, come, oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appears. O come, thou branch of Jesse's tree, free them from Satan's tyranny, that trust thy mighty power to save, and give them victory over the grave. Rejoice, 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 Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Come, thou day spring, oh, come, thou day spring from on high, and cheer us by thine roaring night. Dispense the gloomy clouds of night, and death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, 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 Emmanuel, how come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, 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 Emmanuel, now to thee, O Israel. Oh, come desire, oh, come desire of nations bind, in one the hearts of all mankind. Be thou our sad division cease, and be thyself a king of peace. Rejoice, 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 Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, 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 Emmanuel shall. Oh, come, O come, O come, O come. come Emmanuel and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God. Till the sun is burning bright, he has no peace until he makes the wrong things right. He will not rest until his salvation shines and all of the nations see a shining light. He will not rest until the sun you're burning bright. He has no peace until he makes the wrong things right. He will not rest till your salvation shines. All of the nations see your shining light. He will not rest till like the sun you're burning bright. He has no peace until he makes the wrong things right. He will not rest until it's your salvation shines. All of the nations see your shining light.
Take a seat. Hello, everybody. Good evening. For those who don't know me, my name is Tash, and I am a member here at Wycliffe, and I'm going to be guiding you through this evening's service. So just firstly to say, if you are new here, or maybe you just haven't been in a while, it's really great to have you, and we just want to welcome you. And if you are new here, we have some things called Connect cards that you can find at the back of the church, and our welcomers would love to show you where they are. And then if you pop down your details, we can just get in touch with you about some of the things that are going on in the church. Also, we do have some refreshments. The urn was still warming up, so apologies if you've tried to have a tea and it's a bit cold. But it will be there throughout the service, so do pop up and have a cup of tea. And it will still be available at the end, and we normally stay around and say hello to each other and share a bit about our week. So please do that at the end. I'm just going to run through some notices about different things that are happening in the church. And while I do so, and before I forget, we are going to do the offering. This is for something for regular attenders of the church to give financially to the work of the church. So if you are just visiting, do feel free to let the bag pass you by, or the little fun contactless thing. So that's just going to happen while I do the notices. So next Sunday, there will be no 10:45, but instead we're going to have some carol services. So there'll be two, there'll be one at 3 and one at 6. So do come along, please invite your friends. It's an international carol service. So we have people from all different backgrounds, either performing or singing a carol or whatever. So it'd be really great to come along and invite people that you know, maybe your neighbours or someone from work or something like that. Also, if you would be up for serving, we have refreshments that will be served. So if you'd be up for that, you'd have to come at 5:30 to set up, do the serving, and then help pack away at the end. If you'd be up for that, do speak to Jackie, who is waving at the back. But if you don't know who she is, come and find me and I can point you in the right direction. Again, for refreshments and getting involved, if you are around for Christmas Eve, there is a midnight service, which is always very exciting. Thank you for the enthusiasm. And we would really love to have some people to help with refreshments, to help with welcoming, and if you're very good at reading, also help us up. Speak to Paul on that one, or Lucy, and they can plug you into the right people for that. Also, we have something called Bed for the Night running in Reading from Tuesday the 9th of January until the 26th of March. That is to provide a bed for night for those who need it, and they really need helpers to help man that, including or particularly the shift between 10 p.m. and 6:30 a.m. So if that is something you are able to do, that would be really helpful. You can either see Catherine, who I don't think is here this evening, but there is a QR code at the back, or there'll be a link in the Wycliffe Weekly that you can have a look at to get involved with that. Also, today is the last day to fill in a pledge card, hand in your pledge cards. That is for financial giving to the work of the church. And we're trying to encourage people to reflect about giving to the church and how much they give. And so if that is something you would be up for and you haven't already, do find the details at the welcome desk at the end of the service. And finally, just to say, before we move on, there will be no 6 p.m. on the 24th or the 31st of December, but we will be back on the 7th of January for a baptism service, which is very exciting. So definitely come along to that. Baptism services are my personal favourite. So definitely come along to that. So we're just going to move into a bit of a time of prayer, and hopefully my friends Debbie and Paul will come up. Yay! So they are currently at a YWAM Discipleship Training Centre, and they have got some prayer requests, which we will have up on the screen in a moment. So we're just going to spend a bit of time praying for our friends abroad, and so they have specific prayer requests that we can be praying for as part of our church family. But also, obviously, there's lots of things going on in the world that we can also be praying for, so we can pray for conflicts or pray for just winter and the cost of living and people struggling over Christmas, that kind of thing. So it'd be really great if you're up for it to pray with the people next to you. If you really don't want to and you don't feel comfortable with that, just cross your arms and you can just have some time for reflection. That's absolutely fine, so no pressure. But we're just going to have 5 minutes or so just with the people around you, have a bit of time of prayer, and then I'll come back up just to close. Fab. Let's go. Yeah, Father, I thank you for all the incredible work that you're doing as part of this church and for those that we are able to send out to other communities to do your work further afield. And yeah, Lord, I pray specifically for Debbie and Paul that you would be with them, that you would be providing for them, and that they would continue to grow closer to you in all that they do. And Lord, as Nick comes up to speak to us, I just pray that you would be with him, that you would give him boldness, and that you would give him wisdom, and that, yeah, that he would be speaking your words this evening, Lord, to us. Amen.
Hello. It's very nice to be here. My name is Nick. It's actually very cool to see Ruth and Pravin back. I just noticed you guys. Hello, welcome back. Yeah, I never take for granted being here and having you all here. It is really a blessing. So thanks for coming out in the cold, especially. Okay, so I'm going to try to speak up as much as I can. I'm not naturally blessed in the volume department, but we'll try. Okay, so I'm talking about Advent. And I must admit, I didn't really grow up with much Advent around me. Maybe we had an Advent calendar once or twice, but it wasn't really something I remember from my childhood. But as I've kind of prepared for tonight, I think I've been won over on this concept of Advent. So if you're here tonight and you're a stranger to Advent, just like I feel like I was, then welcome to the club. But if you are a huge Advent fan and you grew up with the calendars and everything, then also welcome to the club. I feel like I can be in both camps simultaneously. So I think Advent is really worth talking about. So we're going to be talking a lot about Advent tonight. And I'll start with a quote from someone called Karl Barth. And the quote is, "What other time or season can or will the church ever have but that of Advent?" It's kind of cryptic, but we'll get into it and explore it a bit further. But before we go any further, let's just figure out what does the word Advent actually mean? What does the word mean? Where does it come from? So firstly, the Bible doesn't directly mention Advent, just like it doesn't mention Christmas or Easter. These are traditions that the church has developed over time to display something of significance about the Christian life and the Christian faith and our relationship with God. And this is a good thing, right? So then what is specifically Advent trying to capture? The word Advent roots from the Latin word Adventus, which means coming or arrival of something. It means something or someone is coming. There's almost like a kind of cinematic quality to the word Advent. There's a tension, and like, ooh, something's coming, you're not quite sure, but we know it's on its way. There's a waiting in the air. So what is this arrival that the Advent we're talking about? What is it we're waiting for? In the sense that most of us are used to, this Advent or this arrival is Christmas. We use Advent to anticipate the birth of Jesus. And in this sense, we're anticipating Jesus as a newborn, and we see the classic kind of manger scene that we see in the storefront sometimes, an Advent calendar. That's one side of Advent. But then Boxing Day comes around, I pack it all away, and I move on with my life. So tonight, I'm actually going to put that aside, and I'm going to pack away the major scene for a little bit, because tonight I want to talk about the other Advent, the other Advent. And I'm actually really excited about this other Advent. Because you see, Jesus' birth, sometimes known as the first Advent, and the classic manger scene that we're familiar with, that part of Advent, in a sense, has already happened. The whole Old Testament is waiting for this arrival. They're in this Advent time, and then Jesus arrives, and that's the end of the first Advent. That waiting came to an end. That Advent came to an end. But you see, there's something else that we're waiting for. There's some other arrival that we're anticipating. And this is sometimes known as the second advent. Can you guess what the second advent is? Shout out.
Return of Christ.
Return of Christ. There we go. So, sometimes known as the second advent, the return of Christ. And of course, this is not a popular side of Advent. Have you ever seen a little cute clay mantelpiece of the apocalypse or Christ's return? I certainly haven't. Yeah, that's a good idea. I would buy it. But the second Advent actually really excites me. And the reason it excites me is because, unlike the first Advent, I'm in the second Advent. You and I are in the second Advent. This is not the story of some folk 2,000 years ago, as amazing as that was. We are now in the story. I'll read that quote again, because now it probably makes a bit more sense. What other time or season can or will the church ever have but that of Advent? See, until Christ comes again, we are in the second Advent. Doesn't matter if it's December, January, February, March. We're always in Advent until Christ comes again. Because Christ came as a child, but he has yet to return. And it kind of feels like a movie, right? Like we're in this trough of disillusionment, like at the 20-minute mark in the movie, you're like, oh, what's going to happen? We're in the thick of this tale. But here's the question for this evening. So what? What difference does it make? And how does it change the way we see life, knowing that we are in the second advent? Well, we're going to answer this question by looking at one of the classic advent parables. And it's the parable of the 10 bridesmaids. If you're not familiar with parables, they're stories that Jesus told, and they need exploration. I actually find that the joy is in the exploration, and reading them at surface value is a bit of a mistake. So let's dive in. It should come up. It is Matthew 25, verse 1 to 13. And the text I'm using is from the Amplified Bible, which is similar to the church Bibles, but it kind of incorporates a commentary into the text as well. So it expounds on some of the words. So there we go. It's up behind me. Very good. Okay, so let's read together. This is Matthew 25, verse 1 to 13. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish, thoughtless, silly, and careless. And five were wise, far-sighted, practical, and sensible. For when the foolish took their lamps, they did not take any extra oil with them. But the wise took flasks of oil along with their lamps. Now while the bridegroom was delayed, they all began to nod off and they fell asleep. But at midnight, there was a shout, "Look, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him." Then all those virgins got up and put their lamps in order, trimmed the wicks and added oil and lit them. But the foolish virgin said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil because our lamps are going out." But the wise replied, "No, otherwise there will not be enough for us and for you too. Go instead to the dealers and buy oil for yourselves." But while they were going away to buy oil, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the wedding feast, and the door was shut and locked. Later the others also came and said, "Lord, Lord, open the door for us." But he replied, "I assure you and most solemnly say to you, I do not know you. We have no relationship. Therefore, be on the alert. Be prepared and ready, for you do not know the day nor the hour when the Son of Man will come." Okay, firstly, note that this parable is called the 10 virgins in the NIV translation and the Amplified. Other translations render it as the 10 bridesmaids. Now, in the time and the context of this writing, that made sense. To my ear, it sounds a little blunt sounding. So stick with whatever works. I'm going to say bridesmaids because I'm a prude. Okay, so these bridesmaids are waiting for something. They're waiting for the bridegroom. Now, this is very typical biblical language of the relationship between Christ and the church. Christ is the bridegroom, and the church is the bridal party. These bridesmaids are us, those that come here on a Sunday evening and plop ourselves in the seats. This parable is about us waiting for Christ's return. Okay, so here are some key points about this parable, and they're not complicated. First, it's dark and the bridegroom is delayed. Quite plain. Seems like a very small point, but it's very important to point out. The groom is not here. Jesus is not here. I don't know if any preacher said that from this pulpit. Christ is not here. But in some spiritual sense, it is true. He is here. He's with us. But in a very basic sense, he's not here. If I said, please go take this cup of water and give it to Christ, you would think I'm crazy. And not only is he not here, he's a little bit quiet about when he's coming back. He's given us some details, but no date. In fact, the only thing he told us was don't try and figure out the date. And so just like these bridesmaids, we are kind of indeterminately waiting. And we're waiting in the dark, just like these bridesmaids were. A few weeks ago, we were in church, and Paul asked us to think and name of some words that we feel like they describe God. So everyone kind of uttered their best Christianese. Holy, loving, long-suffering, that was my one. Very good. But there was someone next to us, and she said something different. The word she picked was silent. God is silent. Can you feel the grief dripping off that word? God is silent. And at first, I think there's almost a bit of shame that we feel for saying something like that. But I feel it. And I think we all have felt it. Does it feel like God is on mute? Like you cry out to God, your Father, and all you hear back is the echo of your own voice? The deafening silence? Heavy. Okay, let me introduce the character. Blaise Pascal, some of you may know him. A famous 17th century scientist, after which the standard unit of pressure was named. Very cool way to be famous. And he wrote some really amazing things about the silence of God, this hidden nature of God. He said, any religion that does not say God is hidden is not true. He goes on to say, I marvel at the boldness with which some people presume to speak of God. In addressing their arguments to unbelievers, their first chapter is the proof of the existence of God from the works of nature. But people deprived of faith and grace, i.e. non-Christians, examining with such light as they have everything they see in nature, find only obscurity and darkness. This is not how Scripture speaks with its better knowledge of the things of God. On the contrary, it says that God is a hidden God and that since nature was corrupted, he has left men to their blindness. He's saying this hiddenness, this delay, the silence of God is so fundamental that if we don't mention it to unbelievers, we're leading them astray. Because friends, don't forget that when non-believers look at the world around them, what they see is chaos. They see disorder, they see destruction, they see a lack of God. They see the hiddenness of God. This is the time of Advent. This is the time and space that Advent places us in. Definitely a bit more somber than some of the Advent we're used to. We're bridesmaids waiting in the dark. It's cold outside, and the waiting hurts. I watched the funeral of a young man that was close to this congregation, and his friends spoke at the funeral. And in tears, he finished his speech, "Lord, come quickly. Come quickly, Jesus." He felt it. He felt the bite of the cold night. And scripture resounds with this as well. Romans 8:22-23 says, "We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we eagerly wait for the adoption into sonship, the redemption of our bodies." We're groaning. And if you're here tonight and you find yourselves on the fringes of faith, and you're struggling as you see people around you joyfully interacting with God, what you feel is totally valid, if not perhaps even more aligned with the true essence of Advent. But I want to point out something to you. This is where it gets really, really mind-boggling. God has hidden himself. Yes, that is true. But then he reveals himself in Christ. We see this in the first Advent. Jesus arrives. After thousands of years of waiting, Jesus arrives. He arrives as a child, meek, and then he goes to the cross to die. And look what happens on the cross. This is recorded in Matthew 27, verse 45 to 46. It says, "From noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over all the land. About 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, 'Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?'" Look at that. It says, darkness came over all the land, and we hear Christ crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Darkness, and Jesus crying out, "God, why are you silent? Speak to me. Why can't I hear you?" Do you ever find it striking that Christ's primary complaint of the cross was not, "Ow, it really hurts." He was saying, "God, why are you not listening to me? Why can I not see you in this space?" This is the whole scandal. You see, God reveals himself in Jesus, but then Jesus too gets a silent treatment from God. What is going on? This is Jesus stepping into our shoes. It's almost like Jesus becomes one of the bridesmaids in the dark. He's on the cross in the dark. God's not talking to him, just like the bridesmaids. He feels what we feel. He feels the silence. He feels that bite of the cold night. And when we say Emmanuel, Christ with us, this is what we mean. Jesus standing in the cold, dark night alongside us, feeling what we feel. Isn't that profound? But it also leaves me asking, why? Why did he do it? There's a whole nother sermon series on the glory of God that we should do one day. And that's one of the primary reasons. But another central reason of why he did it was that so we can have relationship with him. I'm going to repeat that because it gets important from here on out. He wants relationship with us. Look at how the parable ends. So we have these wise and foolish bridesmaids. The foolish ones didn't have oil for their lamps. They try to go out and buy it, and during that time, the bridegroom comes and they're locked out of the wedding feast. Verse 11 says, "Later the others also came and said, 'Lord, Lord, open the door for us.' But he replied, 'I assure you and most solemnly say to you, I do not know you.'" We have no relationship. "Therefore be on alert, be prepared and ready, for you do not know the day nor the hour when the Son of Man will come." This is a tragic ending. The bridegroom arrives, and the foolish bridesmaids don't have enough oil for their lamps. They're not prepared for the return, and they get locked out of the wedding feast. Now at first, that sounded really harsh to me. But as I think about it, I reckon that these foolish bridesmaids weren't really that interested in the bridegroom. Like, I imagine they knew how lamps worked. They knew they needed oil. There's a whole different branch of theology on this interesting fact of the absurdism of them acting as lights, but not actually having any light. They were happy to look like bridesmaids, but they didn't want to get to know the couple. I also must remind you that these bridesmaids in the story are those that would check Christian in a survey. And this is a solemn reminder that simply looking like a Christian or doing Christian things isn't of lasting value. Look again at verse 11. Jesus says to the foolish bridesmaids, "I assure you and most solemnly say to you, I do not know you. We have no relationship." This is where it really hits home. What Christ cares about is relationship. Relationship. This really hit hard for me. Is my greatest pleasure knowing and having relationship with Christ? Doesn't matter about my outward appearances. Doesn't matter how often I come to church. Doesn't matter how much I serve. Doesn't matter how much I give to the poor, to the church. Of course, good things. But here's the thing. Christ wants us to feast with him. Look at the language used in the parable. It's a wedding feast. He wants us to feast with him, to have communion with him, to eat a meal with him. Above all else, why was Jesus born? That we have relationship with him. Why did he die in darkness and with rejection from God? So that we might have relationship with him. And what matters when he comes again? That we have relationship with him. Friends, I believe that the cold night is not forever. That the morning sun will rise. I believe that Christ will return. The end of the second advent. Not as a humble child as he's done before, but with power and glory, and every knee shall bow. And when he returns, I want to know him. And I want him to know me. And I want you there all alongside with me. I want to feast alongside you all, basking in the sunlight that the second advent brings. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for how it poetically and beautifully describes the situation that we live in. I pray that we don't ignore the fact that we are in a time of waiting and that this time hurts. Help us to be sympathetic and empathetic to those around us who are hurting the most. And for those of us who are hurting, bring your comfort and may it be made known to them that you are Emmanuel, God with them. But Lord, help us to keep our eyes focused on the end of the second advent. Help us to treasure our relationship with you more than anything else. And thank you that you've made a way for that to be possible. Amen.
Thanks, Nick. I'm just going to invite the band up. But before we end in some more sung worship, I just thought it would be really great just to stay in this kind of posture of response and just spend a little bit of quiet time individually with God. So at the end of each row, there should be some post-it notes and some pens. If you could take a post-it note and then pass them down the row, and if you haven't got a pen, grab a pen. And we're just going to spend a bit of time reflecting quietly. And on your post-it note, I would like you to write one thing that is getting in the way of your relationship with Jesus. And then underneath it, one practical thing that you're going to do this week as a start to overcome that. So it may be you have never met Jesus before, you don't know who he is, And this is all completely new to you. And one thing you want to do this week is to have a conversation with a friend or open the Bible for yourself or speak to him for yourself. Or it might be that you're struggling with the busyness of life and actually having one-on-one time with him is really hard. So you're going to try and intentionally make time for that this week. Whatever that looks like for you, make a note on your post-it note and then just spend a bit of time in prayer. Prayer is just where we chat to God. It's not anything like super jazzy or spiritual necessarily. You don't have to do anything fun. You just, open your heart to God and just have a conversation with him. So we're just going to have 5 minutes or so just to do that. And then I really encourage you that at the end of the service, you share that one thing that you're going to do with someone that you trust and they can hold you accountable. Because I don't know about you, but if I just make that choice in my brain, I will then leave this place and immediately forget about it and not do it. Whereas if I share it with a friend, then they can check in and go, hey, Tash, did you do that thing that you told me you were going to do? So do you do that? We also... at the end of this, we'll have some people over to the side. And if you would really like prayer or something that Nick said really resonated with you, then do either chat to someone that you trust that you've come with or grab someone to pray at the end. But make a note in your post-it note. And we're just going to have some music playing in the background while we spend some time with God.
Thank you.
We're gonna sing a song now. This is "He Shall Reign Forevermore." It's a song by Chris Tomlin, and he's taken it from a song called "In the Bleak Midwinter." But feel free to stand or sit, however you feel comfortable for this one. In the bleak midwinter, all creation groans, for our world in darkness, frozen like a stone. Light is breaking in a stable for a throne, and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. Unto us a child is born, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. If I were a wise man, I would travel far. If I were a shepherd, I would do my part. But poor as I am, I will give to him my heart. He will reign, and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. Unto us a child is born, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. And he shall reign, and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. Unto us a child is born, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. Here within a manger lies the one who made the starry sky. This baby born for sacrifice, Christ the Messiah. Into our hopes, into our fears, the Savior of the world appears. The promise of eternal years, Christ the Messiah. Here within a manger lies the one who made the starry skies. His baby bore the sacrifice, Christ the Messiah. Into our hopes, into our fears, the Savior of the world appears. The promise of eternal shall reign forevermore, forevermore. And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. Unto us a child is born, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. Here within a manger. manger. Here within a manger lies the one who made the starry skies. The baby born a sacrifice, Christ the Messiah. Into our hopes, into our fears, the Savior of the world appears. The promise of eternal years, Christ the Messiah. And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. Unto us a child is born, King of kings, the Lord of lords. And he shall reign forevermore, forevermore, forevermore. You are here moving in our midst. You are here moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You are here, moving in our midst. Worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, oh, I worship you. You are way maker. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 You are here touching every heart. You are here touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here turning lives. You are here turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. Oh, I worship you. You're a way maker. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You're a way maker, oh, you are a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. You want to see it. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Oh, oh. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Who you are. That is 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 who you are. Oh. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that you came to make the way for us. You came to this earth as a child, so we knew that you are like us, even though you are our God and from God. You are not far from us because you came to become one of us. And how amazing miracle that is. And now we know that you are like us, we can follow you. And you indeed have made the way for us to your kingdom, to eternal life. And we look forward to that, Lord. And we look forward to the journey to your kingdom. We praise your holy name. Amen. We're going to finish with a song, and I've been reflecting on this song and what Nick has been saying, and you probably know this one well, Oh Praise the Name, and it's probably associated more with Easter than Christmas, but it occurs to me, this is the story of the second advent. This is about Jesus coming again. Final verse. He shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night. And I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. So let's end with this song. And as we invite and call on Jesus Christ to come quickly, to come again and transform our lives and our world. Let's do it. Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down on Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Praise his name. Oh, praise the name. forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, O Lord, O Lord our God.
Then on the third, the break of dawn, and on
the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, praise the name.
He shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus. Let's sing that again. He shall return.
He shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus.
Service. Like I say, we have refreshments. Please do stay around and let's chat, have fellowship together. And if you haven't yet had any prayer and you would like some, either grab someone next to you that you trust or do come and receive prayer. Great. Have a great week.